the Holy Spirit to, or wait for a massive like sign in the sky to tell us, all right, be anxious for nothing. We should have the word of God so hidden in our heart that when those things come, we're able to walk by the Spirit. Does that make sense, girls? Amen. Amen. So we are to walk by the Spirit. We're not bound by the emotions that we feel. We have to choose truth. I have a saying, I say, put truth on a pedestal. Put truth on a pedestal. Not how I feel, not my emotions. Put truth on a pedestal. Sometimes your friend might upset you. Your friend might say some things that are hurtful and, you know, are quite unkind. But then you ask yourself, what's the truth in this situation? The truth in the situation is that she loves me. The truth is that she's just upset. So when we have the truth on a pedestal, it allows us to know that, okay, maybe she didn't mean to hurt me. You know, we're able to relegate our emotions. And I'm very, very passionate about this topic because I believe that the enemy's out to get us as young girls. As I mentioned, I feel like we embody a part of Christ Jesus that is a part of God the Father that men don't always embody. We have that sensitivity to things. Does that make sense? That's why they call us emotional. We're not really. But we have that sensitivity. But what the enemy does is that sensitivity to keep us bound and to keep us feeling down. But we have to be women that say, no, I'm not my feelings, I'm not that bad result, I'm not any of that. I'm going to walk by the Spirit. And the Spirit tells me that God has called me to be his daughter. The Spirit tells me that I have a hope, I have an expected end. Amen? Amen. So what are the faithful disciplines that I talk about? You know, we always hear, read your Bible, pray every day if you want to grow. And those are disciplines. But we have to do it with a heart of faith. So my question was, how do you trust God when you don't feel like it? How do you believe God when you don't feel like it? When this Christian walk is becoming a little bit tedious, which it does at times, or when Bible reading is becoming a bit tedious, how do we still walk in a manner worthy of the gospel? And that's what I call the faithful disciplines. The first one we all know is prayer. But I don't say just sit and just pray empty words to God. You know, just sit and just fill up that 30-minute slot because you know you have to because your sister's going to ask you about it. But to have faithful prayer. Faithful prayer to me looks like, Father, I don't feel like you're here, but I know you are. So I command my feelings to come in alignment with what I know. Do you see what I did there? It's faithful because I'm not just empty, I'm not just uttering empty words to the Lord, but I'm saying, do you know what? No, God, I don't feel like it. And I'm being very, very honest and being very, very frank, but I know you are. And you are a reward of those who diligently seek you. So I'm going to seek you. So prayer is one of those faithful disciplines, and it's communication with the Father. But we need to be very real about our struggles. Recently, well, this year I've learned to pray about everything. Like when a situation just isn't looking right, and I know that my heart is hardening, and I know that I'm growing indifferent, and I'm growing a bit irritated, because, you know, we all get irritated. I just said, you know what, God touched my heart, because I can't. I just can't, like, God, I can't deal, like, touch my heart. Or, Holy Spirit, just minister to my heart right now because I need you to help me because if you don't, it's about to get heated in this place. You know what I mean? But to really sit before the Lord and with a heart of willingness as well. I preached on willingness in church 2 weeks ago. And the following week, every situation was just popping up to make me unwilling. But with a willing heart, I just say, God, do you know what? Touch my heart because I know the way I'm feeling is not godly and it doesn't represent you well, but I want to be a model of good works. That's Titus 2:7. So prayer. Secondly, praise. We all know about praise. I do something called a 2-minute praise break. Amen. You know how they do it in America. I don't do the stomping and all of that kind of stuff. But when I was working, I would just go to the bathroom for like 2 minutes and just call God by every name that I know him to be. God, you are the lifter of my head. When I feel ashamed, Lord God, Father, you lift up my head and you place me on a high hill. And I start to quote those verses, quote the names of God. God, you are El Gibor. That means the mighty God. Father, you are El Roy. That means you see me. And your eyes are close to my struggles. You see everything that I'm going through. Does that make sense? You are my shepherd. You are the good shepherd, actually. And when I say those things, that's how we praise God. We extol him, we exalt him. And what praise does is praise actually deceives our emotions. So when you feel downcast and you start praising God, all of a sudden it's like, am I down or am I sad or not?
Am I?
And then what happens is your emotions eventually catch up to the truth of who God is. So praise deceives our emotions in a good way. It lifts the atmosphere and gives us an eternal perspective where we're able to see that these present light momentary sufferings are not worthy to be compared to the glory that will be revealed in us. The Bible lets us know that he inhabits our praises. How many of us, in the times where we feel down, in the times where we feel emotional, in the times where we just don't even want to, how many of us will say to ourselves, no, I'm going to praise you, God, because you are good? How many of us will say, do you know what, God, I'm going to actually set apart 2 minutes, just to 120 seconds, and just call you good? Even if it's one name of God that you know, God, you are good. Repeat it until you believe it. God, you are good. And to me, to be good means that his plans for you are good. So whether it looks good or not, the end is good. Does that make sense? So when you repeat that to yourself, what you do is you're tricking your emotions, yes, but you're also deceiving your emotions. You're even telling the enemy, listen, what you're trying to do with my emotions is not going to work because I know better. I walk in the spirit. Amen? Thirdly, meditation. And meditation, I break up into different categories. But whatever we think on, it controls us. Whatever we think on gets magnified, it controls us. You get a bad grade at school and you're just meditating upon how, okay, if I get that grade, I'm not going to get this job. If I don't get this job, I'm not going to get this type of husband.